John, do you remember the first time you heard Leadbelly's music and the impact that that had on you?
Well, I guess it was around about 1953 or 54 when I heard Lonnie Donegan doing Leadbelly's songs. It was two sides of a single that was enormously successful for Lonnie in England when we had the skiffle craze started. And Lonnie chose the Rock Island Lion as one side, enormous hit, and Leadbelly's version of John Henry on the back. And, you know, when I saw the name Leadbetter in there, I thought, let's find out more about this man. So there were a few recordings of Leadbelly started to become available at that time in the 50s, and I gradually started assembling a collection of Leadbelly stuff, including some vinyl material that I still have, the Folkways Ramsey recordings, the Leadbelly's Last Sessions, which I recently acquired, thanks to your good self, in the CD format. But I'm still very proud of the vinyl set that I've got, and it's still in relatively mint condition, which is something when you consider that the albums came out in 1953, I think it was. And over the years, of course, I've built up quite a massive collection of Leadbelly stuff. I don't think there's any recording of Leadbelly's that I haven't got.
After you discovered Leadbelly, did you find other people in England in the early 50s, mid-50s, that shared your enthusiasm for him?
Oh, yes. There was a fellow that I met around about 56, 57, a guy called Pete Watson, who was the ultimate Leadbelly fan. Although he had only a six-string guitar, so he was doing all the Leadbelly tunes on six-string. But of course, Leadbelly's material just lends itself so well to the 12-string. I was one of the very first people in England to ever get a 12-string guitar. And it was, I think, 1957 I got my first 12-string, built by a fellow called Anthony Zamiatis, who, of course, went on to custom-make guitars for Ronnie Wood and Keith Richard and Eric Clapton. He's a very well thought of guitar maker now. But I had the very first guitar Tony Zamiatis ever made, and it happened to be a 12-string. So, of course, I started learning all the Leadbelly songbook. Now, what I would like to do eventually is to find a way of stringing my guitar so I could tune it really low down. Now, I think Leadbelly's tuning went down almost as low as B. But I don't know where he would have found strings thick enough to tune down that low, because the thinner the strings are, of course, and you tune it down low, then it's going to sound like a barbed wire fence. So you've got to have something very substantially thicker, string-wise, for it to work. So I'm going to have to do some investigation into that. Maybe I can get some tips from the Leadbelly Society. Maybe they can help me. I do know that they have Leadbelly's original Stella guitar, the one that he played back in the 40s, and I think they were going to auction it off. I hope it goes to, either a deserving musician or a museum. Whether I could ever afford it, I don't know. But it was an amazing instrument, apparently. I've never seen it, but I've seen pictures of it. And the strings look as if they're about a quarter of an inch off the fretboard. So I guess you'd need to be a very powerful person with very powerful hands, as Leadbelly did have enormously powerful hands. It needed his strength to be able to even play that guitar.
John, one of the Leadbelly tunes that you recorded, I think back in 1971, was Black Girl. And it seems to me that that was the first version, the first cover version that that a lot of people had heard of that tune. Would that be fair to say that, or did you hear another version of Black Girl before your own cover?
I never heard it done by anybody else before I did it. That's not to say that other people hadn't done it. The only version I ever knew at that point was Leadbelly's own version. Well, he recorded it several times over the years of his life. No, I can't think of anybody else who did it. Now, people have done it subsequently, of course, including Kurt Cobain from Nirvana. Now, whether he was influenced by my recording or Leadbelly's recording to do that tune, I really don't know. And, of course, he's not telling anyone now.
What are some of the other Leadbelly tunes that you've recorded throughout your long career?
Well, I did actually some stuff that are still on tape in England somewhere back in the mid-70s. And I think most of the tape did include Leadbelly material. Let me see, I think the Ella Speed was on that particular recording, and could the Rock Island Line have been on there as well? It's possible, I suppose. There are other things that I've done, including Good Morning Blues, which is, you know, heavily associated with Leadbelly.
What is it about Leadbelly's music that that touches you?
Well, I think it was the very strength of the man, and getting back to what I was saying earlier about the depth of his guitar playing, because, you know, it was tuned that so many keys down from what is, you know, normal concert pitch.
Would it be safe to say that without Leadbelly's music, there would have been no skiffle revival and no R&B scene that developed into the blues revival and all those things that... those great things that happened in England that you were part of?
I think it's safe to say that if there'd been no Leadbelly and if there'd been no Big Bill Brunsey and, of course, Muddy Waters as well, there wouldn't have been that initial thing to capture us, to drag us in, which happened with so many of, the people I was growing up with. And, of course, the people who came a little later, like Keith Richards and... Mick Jagger and the Davis Brothers from the Kinks, and the list just goes on and on. But Leadbelly and Bill Brunsey were the major catalysts for us.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, Holger.